Hello and welcome. In this video, I'm going to talk about convolution, transfer functions, and impulse functions. So hopefully this will bring together some of the topics covered in the last two videos on this playlist. So I'm going to address the problem that we've been talking about for a little while now, which is with Laplace transforms, and that is differential equations of the form a y double prime plus b y prime plus c times y. And in general, we would have a function g of t on the other side and an initial condition y of 0. Now, we could do this more generally, but I'm going to focus on the simple case of y of 0 equals 0 and y prime of 0 equals 0. Okay, so if you take a transform of both sides of this differential equation and divide through by by the coefficients on the y terms, you end up with the transform of the solution y of s, capital Y of s, is equal to 1 over as squared plus bs plus c multiplied by the Laplace transform of little g, which I'll denote by big G. And so this coefficient here, or this function that multiplies g of s, is referred to as the transfer function. So the transfer function h of s is 1 over as squared plus bs plus c. And if we're able to invert capital H to get little h, then we can write down y of t, and y of t will be h convolved with g evaluated at t. And that is a convenient way of solving ODEs, where you end up with a product of two Laplace transforms that you can invert both. Okay, so but there's a more general phenomenon going on here, and that is when g of t is equal to the delta function, delta of t, we get that, as above, a little h of t that you get from this case is going to be equal to the inverse transform of 1 over as squared plus bs plus c. And this is given the name, this h of t is given the name impulse response. And this is a kind of Green's function, if you've heard that word anywhere else. So this is a Green's function in the sense that it's the solution to a linear ODE where you have some linear operator acting on y, and you set that equal to the delta function instead of just some arbitrary inhomogeneity g of t. And the solution to this is the response of the system to an impulse, where delta of t is called an impulse. And so that is the language around this particular solution to the L of y equal delta of t. So I'm going to go on a little bit further here to give an example that hopefully will give a little bit more practical interpretation to the transfer function and also to the impulse response. So the example that I want to go through here is a model for memory. And so let's go through what I mean by that. So imagine that you are totally dependent on your phone for keeping track of everybody's phone number. I don't know anybody who remembers a phone number anymore, not even my own often. So let's say your contact list somehow got deleted and you're forced to memorize phone numbers. So I know this is traumatic to think about, and I apologize. I should have put a trigger warning at the beginning of this video. So let's call n of t the number of phone numbers that you remember. So n of t is going to be the number of phone numbers remembered at time t. And you forget phone numbers at a rate k. All right, and then we have some input of phone numbers. So g of t is going to be the number of phone numbers per unit time that you memorize. And you can be doing this on an ongoing basis. Even ones that you forgot, you can be putting them back in. So g of t is the number of phone numbers per unit time memorized. So this sounds very different from other things that we've talked about, but you can sort of think of this as being like a tank problem in the sense that what's leaving is some number of phone numbers at some particular rate. What's coming in is a number of phone numbers, and we're trying to keep track of all the numbers that are still in the tank or in your brain. Okay, so the differential equation that we would write down for this would be n prime equal the number that disappear per unit time plus the number that are inserted per unit time. And so what can we do with this g of t? So g of t may be some complicated function depending on when you meet people and when you realize that you've lost your phone numbers and so on. But what we can do is we can just ask the question, what happens to a single phone number remembered or committed to memory? So how do I represent that? Well, I'm going to make g of t equal to delta t, and that is I get one memory inserted at moment t equals zero. And so what I can do is then use that to find h of t. I can find h of s first. So h of s is the transfer function. Then that will be, let's say, s times n. Oh, yeah. And what we'll do is we're going to say that n of 0 is equal to, oh, not in up here. In general, we could have n of 0 equals some n naught. But now down here, I'm going to have n of 0 be 0. And then I'm inserting a memory at time t equals zero. So these are sort of kind of related problems, having an initial condition that's non-zero or having an initial condition that's zero and then inserting one phone number at the beginning. But I'm going to express it in terms of the delta function for generality. So what I can do now is I have this s times n plus k times n is equal to the Laplace transform of the delta function at zero is just one, and so I get that n of s is equal to one over s plus k. And now I can get n of t from this, and n of t in this case is what we call h of t, and that is the impulse response. So that's equal to e to the minus kt, which is the inverse transform of this function here. Okay, so what that tells me is that if I have a single phone number that I insert into my brain at time t equals zero, then it'll exponentially decay away from my brain. So you can think of that in a number of ways. One of the ways of thinking about this, and this requires a little bit more probability theory, but you can think about this as the probability that the phone number is still in your brain as a function of time decays exponentially, or you can think about it as, let's say you lose several digits of the phone number on the first day and then a few more on the second day, and then all of them will be gone after several days. And that process is sort of an exponential loss of digits. I mean, none of these are really good models for phone number memory, but the point is that there's some time course of what happens to a single phone number, and that's what the impulse response should be interpreted as. Now what you can do with this, though, is you can then figure out what happens if g of t is not equal to the delta function. So g of t is equal to any function, let's say any continuous integrable function, I'll just write any function here for short. and so if that's the case, then I can write down n of t more generally as the integral from 0 to t of h of t minus w times g of w dw. And that could be written down once I know that h of t is given by e to the minus kt, then this is the integral from 0 to t of e to the minus t minus w times g of w dw. And so let me make a little bit of space on this page over here so that I don't have to flip and lose all the reference to the notes I've got here. So let me over here draw just a little picture of what this integral means. And so it's a little tricky to do this, but let me try to do it on the fly. So I've got g of w is just how many phone numbers I've inserted into my brain as a function of time. So that gives me some curve, let's say like this. So maybe I'm busy with other things and I'm only putting in a few phone numbers, and then I'm like, oh man, I gotta call lots of people. So I sit down one weekend and I spend a whole bunch of time putting all these phone numbers into memory. And how many of those am I gonna remember at time t? So at any moment t over here, I want to figure out how many of them I still remember. Well, obviously anything ahead of t is not in my brain yet. So I'm gonna get at most the ones that are up to this point. So that is why the integral goes from 0 up to t. So this integral here is going from 0 up to t. And then you'll notice, what am I doing? I'm taking e to the minus t minus w. So that is going from t backward in time, t minus w. So I'm subtracting, you'll notice I'm integrating from 0 to t. So what I was saying just a moment ago, where I'm going from 0 up to t in w, the actual thing that I'm plugging in here is t minus w. So that means that I am going backward in time along the exponential. So as I go back here, I'm multiplying g of w, which is the curve that I've got drawn, by an exponential function backward in time. And I'm going to represent that. Let's see if I can do that with different intensities of blue. So let's say initially the memories that I just inserted today are going to be crystal clear, very bright in my memory, very dark blue, and that gets a weight of 1 multiplied by g of w. And then as I go further back in time to previous moments of committing things to memory, I'll have a lighter memory here. Like, it won't be quite as vivid from a little while ago, and I can continue going back in time. And the intensity of this blue represents how many of the memories committed that long ago are still fresh in my mind. And the further back I go, the more degraded the memory becomes, because I have that exponential term that multiplies them. And so then I get a lighter and lighter contribution the further back I go. And so if I now integrate the g of w and I downgrade the memory way back here and keep the memories, the recent ones, in full intensity, then it's really the sort of intensity of blue that I have as a function of t that I'm getting from my n of t over here. And that is one way of thinking about the convolution and the use of the impulse response to solve general equations of this form here, with the g of t not being restricted to just, say, the delta function. Okay, so that is my example to try and help illustrate in a more practical way how the convolution of your g with your impulse response helps you solve these differential equations.